Hi, everyone. I still don't know how to say good morning in Armenian. I'm sorry. There we go. I know two words in Armenian that represents 3 days' effort. Ayo and Vach. So I want to thank you for your welcome to your beautiful country. I've enjoyed my time here. I've taken the opportunity to walk out in the streets of Yerevan and look at lots of things, statues and parks. And I've had the chance to go out into the country a bit as well. I've been fortunate in my time, in my career, to be able to travel quite a bit. And one of the things I've learned about traveling is to always bring my own coffee, because people drink it differently everywhere. And as a Canadian, I have to drink many cups of coffee every day. But I saw this. This is coffee, right? And it took me a while, it took me several days actually to figure that out, that that's what that sign means. How do I pronounce that word? Sorry? Jazvit. Oh, it's pronounced the way it's spelled. Oh, well, that's handy. So now I know three words in Armenian. Jazvit. And I know the most important word in Armenian. Traveling has given me a unique perspective on the world. And it's one I don't dismiss lightly. It's very few people who are able to do that. And one of the things that I've learned, and I learn something everywhere I go, and that's why I like to wander around the streets of your city and of your country. One of the things I've learned is that people speak different languages everywhere I go. And not just, you know, the language that we might expect, like Armenian or Russian or English or Spanish, but they speak in a multiplicity of languages. And what I mean by that is we speak not just with words. We speak with gestures, we speak with actions, we speak with the cities that we build, with the signs that we make, the statues in the streets, the clothing that we wear. All of these things, when I visit a place, all of these things are the people of the city speaking to me. And so for me, the most valuable thing I can do when I come to a place like Yerevan is to listen, to look and see and hear what all of you together say to me. And it's always interesting and it's always new. And when I think of the theme Beyond Borders, that's the kind of thing that I think about. I don't think so much about crossing international boundaries, although that's part of it. I think of the many different ways that we all speak to each other and the many different ways we can all understand each other. So, I was invited here, at least in part. It was in the introduction, which I missed. Sorry. Because I invented something called the Massive Open Online Course. I say I invented it. That would be, it's a bit much to put on one person. I don't think any one person invents a thing. But George Siemens and I together created an online course that was open, and it turned out to be massive. And then Dave Cormier and Brian Alexander were having a conversation, and they called it a Massive Open Online Course. And there you go. We have invented the Massive Open Online Course. And that's what I'll talk about today, to a certain degree. So this is the history of the Massive Open Online course, and as you can see, at the top is what we call the connectivist branch. That's the branch that we created. And then in the blue below is what we call the Stanford branch. Sometimes these are also called, at the top, the C MOOC for connectivist MOOC, and the X MOOC for, well, I don't know. And it's my fault because I picked the name C MOOC and X MOOC, and I didn't really have an X. It's like TEDx or MITx. It's X MOOC. This may be extended MOOC, but there's no real meaning for it. We've continued on over the years. We've offered a number of MOOCs over the years, and I'll talk about those. The X MOOC did what Stanford does and turned into a bunch of companies that are offering open learning for profit, turned into a thing from MIT called edX, which only recently started doing open learning for profit. And so we have kind of two models here. We have on at the top what we might call a community-based model, and at the bottom, an institutional-based model. And as you may have guessed, I'm an advocate of the community-based model. And what this talk is about what that means. So what does it mean? What does it mean to favor a community-based model over an institutional-based model? Well, the point of the MOOC, the Massive Open Online Course, is to be open. I'm going to talk more, quite a bit more, about what I mean by open. But when we contrast it with the X MOOC, we can see that from the perspective of the X MOOC, to be open means to offer free stuff on the internet, like videos, maybe some quizzes. What I want to say in this talk is that openness means more than just free stuff on the internet. Openness really is a way of thinking. It's a way of relating to the world. It's an attitude that we have. You know, a lot of us think of open learning, we think YouTube videos, we think Khan Academy, getting stuff for free. But openness, to my mind, turns that on its head, flips that. And it's more about sharing than it is about consuming. And I think that's probably the big difference between a community-based MOOC and an institutional-based MOOC. This community is about sharing. Institutions are about consuming. It's also about a way of thinking of the world, a way of learning about the world. And I'm going to talk quite a bit more about this, but I want to introduce this theme here. Open in the connectivist way of thinking is about creating harmony through diversity. We can contrast that with the institutional model, which is typically creating harmony through unity or sameness. And you'll see the characteristically different delivery modes between the connectivist MOOC and the institutional MOOC, and indeed between what I call network learning or free learning and traditional learning or institutional learning. So let's talk about this for a bit. Let's talk about the concept of open learning, of open education, and what was intended by this to begin with. There's a long history of open learning. There's also a long history of commercial learning. When the Greeks were setting up things like the academy 2,300 years or so ago, it was commercial learning, right? You would pay money to go listen to Socrates or Aristotle. But even then, there was the idea of open learning. Even then, there was the idea of creating a resource that could be shared and propagated. We've always had conversations and we've always had schools. More recently, the idea of open learning took, if you will, an institutional form with the creation of what might be called open learning academies or open universities. The first of these, as you may well know, was Great Britain's Open University. Canada, which of course is where I'm from, founded its own open institution based very much on the model of the Open University. It's called Athabasca University. I worked at Athabasca University for 7 years. It was a very interesting experience. And it taught me a lot about the mission of these open universities. My own experience with Athabasca University was to travel into northern Canada. Athabasca itself is a town of about 1,000 people, if you can imagine. And it's in northern Alberta, and if you drive north for 3 hours from Edmonton, which is the closest city, you reach Athabasca, and it's in the middle of a huge forest on the banks of a river. There's 1,000 people and a university. And the university has no students. On the model of the Open University, it is a distance education university, and as such, delivers courses, course content, evaluations, and assessment using a variety of technologies. When I worked with Athabasca, we used paper-based learning materials, learning packages, we called them modules, and we would support that with telephone tutoring, and that's what I did with them. I was a telephone tutor, and I would call, I had 40 or 50 students, I'd call them every week or every 2 weeks and ask them what they were doing, and they would answer, nothing. So I had to prod them a bit. That was my main role, was to prod them and keep them going so that they would finish the course. And it's interesting because the model of distance education has very much come to inform the model of online learning. When there's no teacher in the room, when a person is learning at home, they have to have materials that are structured in such a way as to step them through the content. And that's what they would do. That was the model. You would be stepped through the content, very much in the way of a traditional classroom, and what you were trying to do was to learn and remember the content of these courses. It's a model that is spread worldwide. Both the alternative delivery as well as the distance education format. You know, and there's another thing about these open universities too, which characterizes them as open, and that is that there are no admission requirements. When I was young, this was for me the biggest barrier. Well, that and money, because I had none. But admission to a university, because I did not complete high school properly. I did not graduate. I was deficient in mathematics. I am still deficient in mathematics, but less so, happily. And so I was not admitted to a traditional university, not until I became what they called a non-matriculated adult. That's another one for the translator. What that means is an adult without educational qualifications. And so I was finally admitted to the University of Calgary, which had a very open admissions policy at the time. And I was able to start my education 5 years after leaving high school. And that's part of what the open universities are attempting to address, is this hurdle of being admitted to a university. Instead of being something that is restricted, the open universities open their door to anyone who wants to try. And it's a testament to that kind of openness that they have become the largest universities in the world. Indira Gandhi National Online University is one of the largest in the world. It was the largest, but I believe now there's one in China that's larger, but I'll have to look that up. So that's the original meaning of openness, is the breaking down of barriers to access to learning. Over time, with more experience delivering courses, with more experience with open admissions policies, the concept of open has changed and shifted. It means ultimately enhanced or improved accessibility. That's why open universities are typically distance universities. The major thing about Athabasca, and we used to boast of this, is that it was time and place independent. You could study when you wanted to. You could study where you wanted to. And these were important conditions of openness. It was also about the reduction of financial barriers. I mentioned money earlier on. I had none. You know, you go to a university in the United States today, maybe like Harvard or Stanford, the same place where they're offering these MOOCs, and it'll cost you tens of thousands of dollars a year. I've known people, personally known people, who have graduated from university in the United States owing $100,000. What's that in drams? Let me see. 400,000, 4 million, 40 million drams they would owe. Actually, 40 million and 30,000 drams at current exchange rates. The 30,000 really matters. It's crazy. In Canada, the situation is not as bad, but it's still bad. And for me, the cost of attending university was a significant barrier. In Europe, many of the institutions are tuition free, although in Britain recently, they've recently increased tuition, so now it's like £9,000 a year. A pound is about $2, so 9,000, I won't convert it to drams. It's a lot. So these universities were based on reducing the cost of access, although even an Athabasca University degree costs a lot of money. But at least it was more manageable than a traditional degree. And then, to their credit, they also addressed the whole issue of progressive pedagogies. The idea of a kind of support for learning that would help everybody be successful in the end. Because it's hard to teach by distance, it's hard to teach online, it's hard to teach in a classroom, and it's interesting that a lot of these pedagogies in turn became influential in the classroom. But distance learning progressed from the original transactional theory by Moore to Gagne's methods, Merrill's accounts of constructivism, and gradually over time the sort of pedagogy employed by these distance and open universities focused more and more on the engagement of the learner with the material, and indeed, we read Terry Anderson today, engagement with the professor, with personal presence, with interaction and community. There's a progression that has happened here. These institutions started out simply delivering content. That was their original method. But over time, they became focused on building community, and they're to be commended for that. But there is open in the sense of open access, and concurrently with open learning, there has been a significant and strong open access movement over the years, both in terms of open access generally and in terms of open access to learning materials specifically. It's interesting that during the introduction, she mentioned that Richard Stallman was here, maybe on this very stage. I might be standing where Richard Stallman stood. That's cool. I can talk to the ghost of Richard Stallman. Hi, Richard. No, never mind. He'd be turning over in his grave if he heard that. I'm just kidding. He's still very much with us. Richard Stallman, of course, is important for open source software. And the idea that, maybe I shouldn't say open source software, he would turn over in his grave if you heard me say that. He is well known for the foundation of free software. And the difference is, it's not just software that you can access, it's software that you can do stuff with. Ms. Stallman is well known for his four freedoms, and these include the freedoms to reuse, but also the freedom to modify and the freedom to share what you've modified. And so it's an expanded idea of openness. I think it's a very important concept. In the world of content, it's a little bit different, and Stallman's four freedoms don't translate exactly to content, and he'd be the first to say that. I asked him about that, and he said, no, it's just software. Content is something else, and he's Richard Stallman, so it's like, no, it's software. It's content is something else. He's very expressive. So we have online things like Project Gutenberg, which actually existed before the World Wide Web, to create digitized copies of the world's great literature. And there are hundreds and hundreds of texts in Project Gutenberg. If you can read English, you have access right there to the bulk of the world's literature in English. It'd be nice to see Project Gutenberg expand to many other languages, including Armenian. It's interesting. I was walking along the street, walking along your new mall, by the way, and two young women approached me. They said they're college students, university students, I should say. They asked why I was here. I told them. They asked if I knew any Armenian literature, and sadly I had to reply, no, I did not. I only know two words in Armenian, and so I don't know the literature. But with initiatives like Project Gutenberg and with things like automated translation, Armenian literature would become accessible to me, and then some future version of myself walking down some future version of your mall would be able to answer, yes, I do know Armenian literature. I read some on Project Gutenberg for free. There's a thing called the Open Archives Initiative. It begins as a technical initiative. It's a set of standards and specifications to provide access to academic works. So we have the Budapest Open Archives Initiative and various declarations around the idea of making academic literature freely accessible. We have ROAR, R-O-A-R, which stands for the Repository of Open Access Repositories. And there are today thousands of journals online where you can access and read academic literature for free. I would be remiss if I did not mention the Public Library of Science, PLOS, and PubMed, Public Medicine, which again are very important and influential bodies of open access literature. DSpace is technology that was created by MIT, and basically what it is MIT's version of Open Archives Initiative software. It's the institution. It's the ex-MOOC of the 2000s. Also, on a more participatory note, and you're probably familiar with this, is Wikipedia. And the idea here is not only is the content free, the idea is that the community creates the content. And this marks an important advance in the idea of open content. It marks, again, the idea that content isn't something we consume or isn't simply something we consume, but also, and equally importantly, it's something that we create. Before coming to Armenia, Wikipedia and an associated site called WikiTravel were important resources for me. Important because I knew I could trust them and rely on them, because they were probably written by Armenians or people who had traveled to Armenia. So it was authoritative and it was very useful. And, you know, where I live in a small town in Canada. There are no books about traveling to Armenia. You may not believe this, but I tried to find some because I knew I was coming here, and there are none. So for me, Wikipedia and WikiTravel, these were my only sources of information about Armenia. The idea of the wiki, the idea of content that we create for ourselves and share, has been carried over to other initiatives, Wiki Educator, Kuriki, Wikiversity. You can look these up on Google, and again, these are all sources of free and open learning online. Let me linger on Wiki Educator briefly. Wiki Educator started as a community of people who are putting courses in wikis, and it still is that. But in cooperation with the Commonwealth of Learning, they created something called the Open Educational Resource University, OERU. So anyhow, what they did is they developed what they call a logic model for the conversion of open access courses to university credentials. And there's a lot that's right about this initiative, and there are some criticisms that I have. I'll focus on what's right about the initiative. What's right about the initiative is the idea that colleges and universities can access learning resources that are created by the community. They can share them, they can modify them, they can adapt them, and they can use them in the delivery of courses. And they can exchange these courses with each other and offer them in such a way that students taking these courses from member institutes of Open Education Resource University can ultimately be assessed and granted a credential. Somebody asked me outside in an interview just this morning, do you think that people will be able to get university credentials online? And my answer to that was yes, unequivocally. It's being done now. This is what Open Educational OER University is doing. And the model, though, is I'm not completely happy with it. And I hesitate to criticize it because they do good work. But the model begins with open, and then as you rise through the different levels to, you know, from to the delivery of instruction, to the assessment by institutions, to the granting of credentials, it becomes more and more institutional. So it's kind of a very clever progression from free and open to closed and institutional. Now, a lot of people want degrees that are granted by institutions. And so this model works for them. The question that I have is this model the best model for open education generally? And so I have criticisms. Very gentle, kindly meant criticisms, because they're all good people, but criticisms. And the main criticism that I have is that it's focused very much on a traditional form of learning. It is not learning as community, it is not learning as interaction. It is learning on the basis of the presentation of information which you remember in order to take a test and get a degree. This is based on a very traditional, institutional sort of model. And there's this tight link between open education and university and these credentials. You have to, in order to receive a degree or diploma or recognition, you have to pay one of these institutions money. You have to go through one of their assessments. And so there are still hurdles. There are hurdles in terms of access. There are hurdles in terms of finances. And there are hurdles in terms of what it is that is valued as an academic credential and what it is that is not valued. It's open learning. Yes, it's open learning in the model of the open university, in the model of Athabasca University, but it's not free learning in the sense that Richard Stallman would say. It's not free learning in the sense that you can take an education, remix it, remodel it, revise it, and share that as you're learning. It's learning only for consumers of learning, but not learning for creators of learning. And so I'm critical of it. It's learning what Paulo Freire would call the banking model of learning. It's learning where you bank information into your head. You deposit facts the way you would deposit money into a bank if you had money, which I don't. So look at some of the ways in which this traditional model is different from a more open kind of model, the model that I would describe as free learning. Look at the delivery. We can characterize the delivery. In traditional learning, the institution or the professor sets the learning objectives for you. So first thing is first lesson, first day of the class. The professor gets up, our objectives in this class are to do this, 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 and this. Contrast that with a very different model where a group of people gets together And each person has his or her own individual objectives. Compare, you know, look at this room here. You're all here on a Sunday morning, which I really appreciate, by the way. And I have no expectation or belief that you all share the same objective in being here. That would be absurd. Some of you, well, I'm not even going to speculate. You all have individual, different motivations for being here. Or the organization of the subject matter. In traditional learning, the professor, or indeed in open learning, where you have these course packages, which I mentioned earlier, the institution organizes the learning for you. Contrast that with a free model of learning where you organize the material, you organize the order, the priority of the learning for yourself. Well, you might say, well, how on earth could you possibly do that? One of the big objections to it is you're a learner, so you don't know anything about the subject that you're taking. So how could you possibly organize it for yourself? But look at me. I'm a visitor to Yerevan. Think of Yerevan as a body of material to be learned, a language, a culture that is speaking to me and I'm trying to understand. I could have it all organized for me, right? I could arrive in Yerevan, I'd be greeted by a tour guide who will speak perfect English, and will take me from this church to this church to this church to the government building to the park along your nice new mall to Republic Square and then maybe to a monastery. And my learning about Yerevan would be organized for me. I choose to organize my learning of Yerevan for myself. How could I do that? I don't know anything about Yerevan. And honestly, well, I knew it existed. I knew it was in Armenia. I knew where Armenia was. So I had some background knowledge, but really, I could not be trusted to organize my own learning about Yerevan, could I? Well, I can, because I do have a sense of how to organize, how to learn something, even if I don't know what it is I'm learning about. I went to Google. I went to Wikipedia. I got a broad outline. Here's Yerevan. It's a big circle. Well, that's useful to know. And then there's a big mall. And you know, I can figure things out. I learned the words for IO and VOCH, which I figured would be very important. I tried to learn the word for coffee, but didn't know how to pronounce it. Still some other very important words I don't know yet. And then I immersed myself into the subject matter and learned what I needed to know as I went along. It's a different way of learning, isn't it? Open versus closed. Assessment. In a traditional institution, the institution will decide whether or not you are worthy of a credential. Now, you may detect a tone there. Contrast that with an assessment where I decide for myself whether I'm successful. Well, okay, that's probably not going to be good for employment, right? Because otherwise, my next job, I'd go in and I'd say, well, yes, I'm a fully qualified nuclear physicist and I have 4 PhDs. So, okay, there are limits to self-assessment. I get that. But still, there's a big difference between the institution defining what success is and me defining what success is. Again, let's think of me walking around Yerevan. what would count as success in that sort of environment? Well, you know, it's going to be different for every single person who visits the city, right? For me, what is success? For me, learning another word, that would be a success. Taking some beautiful photos, that would be a success. Beginning to comprehend the people and the culture, not knowing, because you can't know it in just a week. If I was here for a year or maybe 10 years, I might begin to know it. But, you know, to understand the flavor, to learn some lessons, to get some insights, these are the things that for me would count as success. I saw some, I assume they were American exchange students at a cafe in the I guess it would be the northwest quadrant. I've decided that must be the American area where they all congregate. There's a bar there called Chicago. I figure that's where they go. And their version of success was having a beer, having a good time. And from my perspective, that's a perfectly valid definition of success. If you're young, if you're visiting Armenia with a bunch of friends, that works too. And I've certainly visited cities and had success that way too. Everybody's success is different in open learning and free learning. And we need to engage with that idea and comprehend that idea. And it's hard to do in a traditional setting where success means mastering this body of content, success means doing these things right. Free learning, as I describe it, free learning is based on a theory of pedagogy called connectivism. And the idea of connectivism is that knowledge is contained not in the set of sentences or facts that you might accumulate, but in the connections or relations between things. It's a very radical theory. It's more radical than you might think at first glance. Because one of the implications of it is that any collection of things that can be related to each other, that can connect with each other, can learn. It's radical because it's almost impossible for us to imagine how that can be the case. But it's the sort of learning, don't you think, that would characterize learning by a community. Think about it. You are a community. You and all of the people in Yerevan and surrounding towns are a community. What makes you a community isn't just the fact that you're all in the same place. That'd be no different than a pile of sand, right? What makes you a community is the way you relate and interact together, right? The artifacts of that community, of that interaction, those artifacts are the language that you speak, the cities that you build, the books that you write, the art that you create, the statues that you erect. The knowledge of your community as a whole is not just the knowledge that's in this person or in this person or in that person, but it's knowledge that belongs to the community as a whole. It's the culture. It's the way of seeing the world. It's the technology. I sometimes use as an example the knowledge of how to fly from Paris to New York. You might think, well, that's really simple. You buy an airline ticket, you fly. But it's not simple. It's incredibly complex. In order to know how to fly from Paris to New York, a society has to know how to make rubber for tires on the airplane. They have to know how to make high strength aluminum airframes, and now today carbon fiber airframes. They have to know how to make windows that can stand the lack of air pressure at 35,000 feet. They have to know how to make jet engines. They have to know how to refine and deliver petroleum to power those jet engines. They have to know how to take, you know, to pilot an airplane, to take off, to fly across the Atlantic, and with luck, land successfully. They have to know how to deliver food in those little styrofoam containers and coffee in half cups because you're afraid it will spill, and to point out the exits are here and here and here. And the entire ticket reservation system, the computers beyond that, there's a system called Sabre which runs all of that. There's a computer language in which that was written. And then finally, the manufacturer of the paper on which the airline ticket is printed. Well, you get the idea, right? No one person knows how to fly from Paris to New York. It's impossible. No person could know all of those details. I can barely list all of the details, much less know them. But it is knowledge possessed by the community as a whole. Not because any individual has it, but because when the community relates and interacts together in certain ways, this knowledge emerges as a property of the whole. Does that make sense? Yeah, it makes sense when you put it that way. But it's a really different kind of knowledge, right? It's knowledge, really, it's beyond any individual comprehension. Okay, well, that's one network, one collection of connected individuals. What if you take a different kind of thing? Let's say human brain cells, neurons. Now, human brain cells are very different from people. Get that. People are complex and interesting. Well, actually, so are human brain cells. But human brain cells are, you know, they're smaller, obviously. They're characterized by electrochemical reactions. They connect with each other. In fact, the human brain is a densely interconnected collection of neurons, right? It's like what Marvin Minsky called the society of mind. We have human society, we have the society of mind. Minsky meant something a bit different, but this will do. And so any individual neuron, it's not very smart. It's a neuron. How could it be smart? All it can do is, you know, receive electrical transmissions and send electrical transmissions. That's how a neuron communicates. But if you get enough of them together, they can, as a collective whole, acquire intelligence. They can learn. They can do things like walk down to the ticket office and buy a ticket to fly from Paris to New York. Any set of entities that is connected can learn. That's the core idea of connectivism. And what's really interesting is it means that the content of learning is not what we typically assume it to be. What is the content of learning? Well, the Battle of Hastings took place in 1064. I forget. I should know that. Paris is the capital of France. What else is the content of learning? In Russia, they speak Russian. 2 + 2 = 4. I don't know. I'm trying to think of other things. A cat is a type of animal. These sorts of things are what we typically think are instances of learning, right? But that's not what we have in our head. We do not have sentences in our head. We do not learn by acquiring collections of sentences. We learn by creating connections between neurons. Our neural network, our brain, is what they call plastic. What that means is the connections between individual neurons grow, they decay, they become stronger, they become weaker. And as these connections change, we learn new things. So connectivism is based on the idea that what we're trying to do is not acquire a bunch of facts. We're trying to grow connections in our brain. You do not acquire knowledge. You become knowledge. You become a thing that knows. That has a lot of implications, as you may imagine. So, what makes for a good learning network? What makes for a good online course? It's not just the presentation of a bunch of facts, because that's not what learning is it? It's the creation of an environment in which you interact and communicate, in which you create and you share. And that's the model that we've tried to pursue in the creation of our courses. The design principle, I call it the semantic principle, I'll talk about it in more detail in a bit, is basically based on the idea of what makes a network most capable of learning. But you can sort of imagine for yourselves right now what that might be like. How could a society work together to learn how to fly an airplane from Paris to New York? Is it all by everyone learning the same thing? Well, clearly not. Because there's so many different parts to it, everybody needs to learn something different. Is it all by you just sit quietly by yourself and don't talk to anyone? Clearly not. You have to communicate as a society. So we can imagine what some of these principles are even now. So most of all, though, let me emphasize, and this is not just me saying this, right? This is knowledge that goes back thousands of years. This is the same knowledge that the monks had when they're being ascetic and living a life of deprivation, because they understand that they learn not by consuming facts, but by becoming something. It's a way of being, a way of living, a way of looking at the world. Learning is a matter of personal growth. How do you grow is how you learn. So, connectivist learning design, then, is non-curricular, which is an almost impossible concept for an institutional perspective on learning to comprehend. In a connectivist course, we do not have a body of content we want to teach people. Now, the reason for that is we expect every person in our course will learn something different. They will learn something of their own choosing, not something that we tell them to learn. The content of the course, just like the content of this talk, you notice I'm talking right now, I'm giving you sentences. Here, have another sentence. Here, have another sentence. Not that useful when I do it that way. The content of the course is what we call the MacGuffin. The MacGuffin, that's a technical term. It comes from the film industry, reportedly from Alfred Hitchcock, but I'm not sure. And the MacGuffin is the plot device in a movie that keeps everybody in the movie interested. It's the thing that they're all chasing. For example, there's a movie called The Maltese Falcon. You may have heard of it. It's a very famous movie. Really good movie, too. And in The Maltese Falcon, everybody wants to get their hands on the falcon. That's the purpose of all of their actions. Now, what's really interesting about that movie isn't the falcon. Nobody cares about the falcon, really. It's the interaction, the characterization, the betrayals, the conflict, the angst. All of that's what's interesting. The falcon, it could be the Maltese goat, for all we care. It's not, because you need something. You know, in the movie The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, it's the treasure. In Raiders of the Lost Ark, the MacGuffin is the Lost Ark. It could have been, Raiders of the Second Rock to the right, but it wasn't, because the idea is that the MacGuffin is what we call the attractor. It is the center of gravity. It is the locus around which all of the characters revolve. But the interesting thing is the interaction between the characters, the locus could be anything. So what is the purpose of this talk? It's not to get you to remember what I said. My slides will be online for the rest of eternity. Well, I hope anyways. Right? So you can always go back and look them up. And even better, I'm recording audio. So there's a word-for-word recording of this talk, which sometime in my future career will be used as evidence against me. Just kidding. So you don't need to remember. So what's the point of even talking? Because I am the MacGuffin. I'm the strange attractor. I'm the person who stimulates the conversation and the interaction. And you might talk about what I said, or you might talk about the new mall, or you might talk about the cat photo in my slides. It doesn't matter. The idea is that that process of interaction will help you in your progression to become a knowing person. So why do it this way? Well, it's better learning, simply. It's learning that's actually useful. It's learning that is actually learning. It's learning that enables you to act in the world rather than to recite facts about the world. It's based on an understanding of network principles. As George Siemens and I like to say, this isn't just stuff we made up, like so much educational theory. I shouldn't say that, but it's true. A lot of it is just stuff that Jean Piaget, stages of life. Yeah, that sounds good. No, it's not just, there may be Piaget fans here. It's based on actual, real principles that we have observed working in other domains and in our domain. Computationally, it's based on the science of connectionism and what they call in that discipline, interestingly, learning theory, which is the set of methods and algorithms for the creation, strengthening, weakening, and breaking of connections between nodes. There's a huge body of literature devoted to learning theory in the field of computer science. It's based also at the same time and concurrently on graph theory. You know, think Leonard Euler and others, the idea of the mathematics of the relations of things. Some of the work that I've done with Daniel Lemire, for example, who's a mathematician. It's based in the work of social network theory, Duncan J. Watts, Alfred Laszlo Barabasi, James Sirwicki, the, you know, knowledge of how societies can learn by interacting with each other. And it's based in an understanding of contemporary epistemology, of if I dare say, postmodernist epistemology, the understanding that knowledge is not semantic and linguistic, but sub-semantic and sub-linguistic. And it's based in the work of people like Stephen Kosslyn, who talks about mental imagery as the mechanism that we use to process information as opposed to following principles or rules of the mind. So it's not just made up. And it's also founded in the principles of what constitute successful networks. And it's a bit rule of thumb, but here's the difference between a successful network and a non-successful network. A successful network is dynamic. It can learn by changing its connections. A non-successful network is static. The connections are fixed. It cannot learn. That's the difference between a human and a sandcastle, right? A human can learn because the connections can change. The sandcastle, it just sits there. It's interesting. It's ordered. Sand particles are connected to each other, but they can't change. The sandcastle cannot learn. It comes back to this idea of in diversity, harmony and growth. The only way for a network to learn, the only way for connections to grow, to form, to shape, to break, is for the individual entities in the network to all be different. If they were all the same, the connections would never change. You can do a simple mathematical model for yourself that proves this. Imagine a collection of entities. These entities can have the value 0 or they can have the value 1. And if a 0 is connected to another entity which has the value 0, that flips to 1. And if the 0 is connected to another entity that has the value 1, that flips to 0. I'm losing myself in my example. Anyhow, if everything in that network has the same value, the network never changes. Because there's nothing for one entity to communicate to the other. It's only when entities have the possibility of different values that any change in state in one can result in a change of state in the other. Sorry, I could have explained that a lot better. I should have rehearsed that example before I tried it. But it's funny though, it's a good example and I'm gonna use it again. I thought of it right now as I was talking, I thought I'd go with it. So, here's our course. What a mess, right? This is the first connectivist course. This is a map of the course. This is what we built. This is on day one of the course. One of the students created it. And it's interesting because you can tell it's the first one. There's still a little bit of structure up there in that upper left-hand corner. That's Moodle. It's a traditional learning management system. George wanted to use it, so I blame him. The rest of it is a mess. But the idea here is, what we're doing is we're applying the same connectivist principle to the course contents and to the course technologies. We embraced diversity, we embraced communications, and look what happened. We didn't use just one learning management system. We used Moodle, we used WordPress, we used an RSS aggregator. What else? We used Delicious, which is a bookmarking site. We used Flickr, which is a photo site. Oh, what else is there up there? I should know these by now. We used a web page. We used Google Groups. A whole bunch of different things. And what we did is we set up all of these areas and we linked them together. And then we told the students, come in and play. And what they did, I don't have a diagram for this, unfortunately, but what they did is they brought their own technologies, their own ideas, their own contents, and added that to the mess. So we had back in 2008, for example, people still used Second Life, which is a 3D virtual environment. We had three separate Second Life communities that were set up, they're called islands, that were set up for this course. Two of them were Spanish speaking, one of them was English speaking. We had people set up Google groups, set up Yahoo groups, mailing lists, websites. We had people set up their own blogs. And the idea here is that as people added more and more things, we created a bigger and bigger network. That network grew, it developed, it changed. Each of us individually learned by being immersed in that network, and the community as a whole learned. One of the things that we learned, this is possible. This actually works. So, our MOOC model, massive open online course, there is no core. There is no center, or if there is a center, it's a MacGuffin. It's like a black hole. Everything revolves around it, but nobody really wants to go there. That's a really good line. I'm going to use that again. The course design, as you just saw, looks much more like a map of a city or a community that you explore with others or on your own. Looks much more like that than a book. A book is for the presentation of textual content, of facts in the form of sentences and propositions, but that's not what we're trying to do here. So we create a map, a living area, an environment in which you immerse yourself and exercise and grow. The resources are distributed and aggregated. What that means is there's no single place for all of the resources. They're all over the place. And the course engine, which is called Grasshopper, is kind of like a circulatory system where it brings them together and spreads them out. Brings them together, spreads them out. Brings them together, spreads them out. I'll be showing that this afternoon. And the participants are encouraged to create their own resources, to bring in things that they've learned, to add to the conversation their own perspective, their own ideas in their own language. English wasn't even the official language of the MOOC. Our first MOOC, we had a large Spanish-speaking component. Our second MOOC, we had a large German-speaking component. I have no idea why, right? It's just that MOOC, a lot of Germans came. We've had large French-speaking components. And it's an interesting thing, and I've done a whole paper on this, or a whole presentation on this, about the idea of cultural propagation, the sharing of cultural values as taking place not through the creation of separate and individual cultural communities, but rather by many cultures participating and sharing in a common multilingual, multi-resource, multi-personal environment. There's some food for thought. Here's another diagram. This is from a video that was created by Dave Cormier. and you can watch it there if you follow that link. Don't worry, that link is on my presentation. My presentation will be available for the end, till the end of time. So will that video. At least Dave hopes so. And again, you get the idea, it's many different things all connected together. It reminds me, I saw, I guess it's maybe a month ago now, people usually think that human neurons are all the same. But in fact, according to the study, there's tens of thousands of different types of neurons. They're all different. Each one of them does a different thing. Each one of them processes signals in a different way. There's diversity even in our brain, which is a good thing, because otherwise, what would we think about? Here's another video that Dave created. This is Dave's version of how to be successful in a MOOC. I would do it differently, but that's fine. But it's funny, right? You can see this as a statement of how to be successful in this course, or it could be a statement of how to be successful when visiting a city for the first time. Orient yourself. Declare where you want to go, what you want to see. Network. Ask people. Consult information sources. Look at the subway map. Cluster. Go where the people are. I do that a lot. If I hear a crowd and I'm in a city and I'm exploring it, I follow the noise because something's happening. Not always good, but something's happening. And focus. Focus your attention. Look at your surroundings. So it's a model. It's not the only model, but it's a model. A guy called Jim Groom, who works at Mary Washington University, created a MOOC even better than ours, but don't tell him I said that, called Digital Storytelling, or DS-106. And in this MOOC, the creative aspect was encouraged much more so. I loved the way he did assignments. He did not give out assignments, but students had to do assignments because it's a real university. What he did is he set up an assignment bank, and people would suggest assignments. Now, by people, I mean anybody, not just people in the course, but anybody. I suggested some. And students look at the list of assignments and they choose what they want to do. And if they don't like what's on the list of assignments, they create their own assignment. DS-106 has resulted in the creation of many movies, videos, animated GIFs, a radio station, more. You have to see it to experience it. But again, it's this idea of learning by immersion, learning by creation, learning by growing. This is an example of educators taking an ex-MOOC, which is all about delivering a set of facts and maybe some videos. And what they did is they said, this is boring, which it was, and they created their own Google Hangouts where they had conversations together. They used live stream to broadcast these conversations so that they could share them with the rest of the world. Basically, they took an ordinary static course and turned it into a MOOC. And that's an essential point about MOOCs. So far, the discussion is focused on this person or that person creating a MOOC. But in fact, you create the MOOCs. You create your own locus of learning. You find the thing you want to follow. You create your community. It's like Etienne Wenger's community is a practice, except it's a course. It's not something that's ongoing. It's something that starts, continues for a while, and stops. But all the rest of it, you create through your interactions. So, MOOCs became famous, and 2011 was the year of the MOOC, and actually I think Time magazine called 2012 the year of the MOOC, but they became really famous. A couple of guys, Norvig and Thrun, created a MOOC called Artificial Intelligence. They were based at Stanford. They copied a model that was pioneered by a guy called Salman Khan. Khan created what was called the Khan Academy, which is a fun name for a bunch of YouTube videos. And basically, he created a whole bunch of really low-quality YouTube videos and basic concepts of physics and mathematics. A neat idea. And a lot of people learned about physics and mathematics from his videos. They took the same sort of idea, but they're in California, so they used high-value production. They made beautiful videos. They created a web-based environment on which to show those videos. They added some artificial intelligence-supported online quizzes, and voila, the Stanford AI MOOC. But it's the same concept, and that's why they took the same name. It's massive open online learning. But it's massive open online learning without the community, without the interaction. It's massive open online learning by delivery only. But this is what everybody focused on. This is what all the media attention's on. And this is what happened. 2014, the year of the anti-MOOC. Everybody's criticizing MOOCs. Dropout rates. People aren't finishing the course. People aren't learning the stuff. People aren't getting credentials like a real course. Right? They took the idea and the philosophy of a MOOC, but they made it institutional, fact-based learning, and it seemed really good for a while, and it was really good for a while, but people began to see the weaknesses of it because it becomes, for the student, something very passive, something where they're not growing and developing, but you know, they might as well be reading a book or watching videos, which is exactly what they're doing. So, key turning point of the talk. I indicate that by saying key turning point of the talk. How do we go from there to there? How do we go from this institutional kind of approach, the banking model, learning as a set of facts, learning that people can't afford, learning that people can't access, learning that people can't use, to a community-based, growth-based, practical methodology of learning? Well, again, there's probably many ways, but here are some thoughts on the subject. First of all, is we need to understand and embrace what we might call new cultures of learning. The culture of learning that moves away from the instructor-centered, instructor-led approach to the more connectivist approach. And when I say move away from the instructor-led approach, I mean not just the traditional instructivist models, but also even the constructivist models, which are more about student engagement, but are still based on the idea of the instructor setting the parameters, the instructor setting the conditions of learning. So, what does this new model of learning look like? Well, this is the semantic principle that I talked about before. The semantic principle, the conditions for successful learning networks. And there are four of them. Oops. But they only work if you go the right way in your slides. The first one is autonomy. If you think of a brain, each neuron has to be acting on its own. It can't be taking orders from another neuron because brains don't work that way. In a society, each person makes their own decisions. You choose what clothes to wear. You choose where you want to go. There are many different aspects of autonomy, and it's not just about, you know, just complete freedom of choice. That would be a very naive understanding of autonomy. One aspect of autonomy is what we might call the freedom from, or the freedom of the capacity to receive. It's kind of badly phrased. It's better up there. Freedom is factors affecting mental states. And I list three: empirical, cognitive, and psychological. And what I mean there is the capacity to experience. You know, you're not autonomous if your world is always gray. Autonomy is the capacity to get out into the world and experience it for yourself. The capacity to think about or reason about the world. The constructivist would say build mental models. This capacity is an aspect of autonomy. The freedom to see the world as you wish to see the world. And then psychological freedom. And there's a whole range of things here. But basically, the capacity to be, think, and act in the world without psychological restraints, without fear, without expectations, etc. Another aspect of autonomy is the freedom to actually act on these psychological or mental states. The freedom to take action, the freedom to see the results of action. And there are different dimensions of action. There's physical action, can you do things? There are social actions, can you form communities? There are structural actions, can you build things? Can you create things? There are resource actions, can you go out into the world and obtain the resources you need in order to have a good life? You can see how all of these things are factors of autonomy and also challenges to autonomy. The scope and range of autonomy has to do with the limits of, if you will, your power. A person can be completely autonomous in a jail cell, but it's not very useful because their autonomy is limited to a 10-foot by 12-foot room. Or I guess that would be, you use meters here, don't you? See, I'm learning about Armenia. You do use meters, right? Okay. You never know. I guess it'd be a 3 meter by 4 meter cell. Never mind. The capacity to associate not just with the community around you, but a community around the world is a limit or an extent of autonomy. All of these factors come into play. And the theory of connectivism is based on, in general, maximizing autonomy. Understanding that maximizing autonomy does not mean autonomy without restraint, because there's a variety of factors involved. So maximizing means within the context and the conditions of society and your life, all of these conditions expressed to the greatest extent. I'm being a bit technical, but I need to be a bit technical. Otherwise, people will say, oh yeah, he just advocated everybody doing whatever they want. That's not what I mean. Diversity. I've talked about this a lot throughout this talk. It's one of these core principles of the semantic condition. Cognition is not possible without diversity. Learning is not possible without diversity. A society that tries to have every person the same will not be a learning society. You can judge that observationally if you want. There are many different types of diversity. Usually when I talk about these topics, I talk in Canada or in the United States, and if you say diversity, the first thing that springs to mind is, you know, racial diversity in the United States. You know, blacks, white, and Hispanics. In Canada, we often talk about linguistic diversity, the right to use one of the two official languages of your choice. But of course, diversity extends well beyond that. diversity of composition is one way of talking about diversity. Many different types of entities. It could be any kind of type. It could be language, could be nationality, could be religion, could be heritage, could be genealogy. There's a wide range of types of diversity based on composition. And my observation is that a community that has many different types of people has much more to talk about. But there's also diversity of, if you will, intention. People want different things out of life. This is one of the things that the economists have never figured out. You talk to an economist, I was at the London School of Economy, of Economics, a few weeks ago. You talk to economists, they say everybody wants to maximize their own personal gain. Now that's ridiculous. Economists want to maximize their personal gain. That's why they're in economics. Other people, I know people who just want to be nice to cats. I have an aunt who does two things. Well, not, she does other things, but one of the major things she does is she adopts rescue kittens and raises them to good health and finds good homes for them. That is a perfectly valid and worthwhile objective. And I would consider that a life well spent. People have different objectives. I just went to a monastery, Gegharde, where people spent their lives sitting in a room in a cave, and that's what they did. That is not maximizing profit for personal gain. That is living a very different life with very different objectives. So having different goals, different objectives, recognizing and promoting them and allowing them, that is a type of diversity. And in the courses that I've taught and the connectivist courses, I've always, from the outset, acknowledged that people have different reasons for being in the course. There's a corollary to that. Sometimes the reasons change and people don't want to be in the course anymore. That's okay. So like I tell them, I promote diversity in my talks as well. You can leave anytime you want. You're not required to be here. It's important. Perspective, points of view. Each of us looks at the world from a different perspective. This recognition is really important. And this is one of the major criticisms of a theory of learning based on the memorization of sentences. Because each of us looks at the world differently, the meaning of every single word in every single language is different for every single person. Think about that. When I say the word cat in English, everybody who listens to me, who hears me say the word cat, thinks something different. Now, some people, some semanticists were arguing, yeah, there's overlapping meaning. My argument is, well, how can you tell? I take it as a point of departure that when I say the word cat, people are going to misunderstand me. No, I did not mean tiger. No, I did not mean your cat, I meant my cat. No, not the black and white one, the tawny one. You know, there's, if you understand from the outset that communication is not an exercise in shared or common meaning, but something quite different, your attitude and your approach to communication changes. And that is a whole talk. Talked a little bit about the mathematics of diversity, so I won't reproduce it. But the mathematics of diversity leads us to prefer a form of organization more characteristic of a mesh than of what we might call a hub and spoke model. In other words, the number of connections from one individual to the other individuals is more or less consistent across individuals. That implies certain structural constraints to networks. But in a practical circumstance, it means that in a course, you don't want to set it up so that everybody follows one person. Rather, and even among the students, in my courses, in my connectivist courses, I told people, actually, don't just follow me. That's ridiculous. You won't learn anything if you just follow me. Follow and read other people. In fact, stop following me and start listening to the other people in the course. You'll learn more. That's not strictly true. I do have something of value. But if everybody just follows me, it's not going to be very valuable. Now you might think, but surely there are some that are more important. Well, even if you grant that, how much more important? Look at the way the internet is structured right now. You have me, I have a few thousand people linking to me, that's pretty good. You have my brother Bill, who has one person linking to him. It's me. And then you have Google, which has like a billion people linking to them. That creates what's called a power law. Google at the top, and then a slope, and then medium, that's me, and then a long tail of everybody else that has only one link. That is not a good learning network. That is not a mesh. In a mesh, you'd have Google with a few thousand links, and me with a few thousand links, and my brother with more than just me. Maybe other people in the family, friends, associates. It's not just, you know, the internet that expresses this pattern. We see the power law exercise itself in the economy as well. The economy is not a mesh, but it should be. In the economy today, we have a power law, right? A couple dozen people own half the world's wealth, and then there's people kind of in the middle, like me, and then there's the long tail of a billion, 2 billion people who have much less money. That is not a mesh form of organization. That is not a society that can learn and grow. So there are economic implications as well as educational implications to connectivism. Openness. I talked about open. Openness is one of the major conditions for network success. This is why open content and open educational resources are important. You need openness to function successfully. You need openness to learn. Imagine how your brain would work if the links between neurons were blocked. And in fact, there are diseases, dementia, forms of Alzheimer's, where that's exactly what happens. And you lose your capacity to think, you lose your capacity to remember. Imagine a society in where the telephone system suddenly stops working. I don't know about Armenia, but Canada would shut down. We'd all sit at home waiting for a phone call. So you need openness. But there are varieties and aspects of openness, as I've said so far. Open content, open teaching. And I've talked about the different stages of openness through open assessment and even open credentialing. Open networks. Networks that allow input, allow communication, allow the freedom to form and break connections. That's how a network learns. And the result of that learning, and you see this characteristically, is the formation of clusters. And these clusters loosely associate with concepts, very, very loosely. And finally, interactivity. This is the idea of learning as emergent. This is the idea of us as a community being able to create new learning by interacting with each other. It's the idea that a bunch of connected things can create something that is contained in no individual members of those things. Gestalt is like that. In Gestalt, you look at a pattern, disassociated black dots, and you see a dog. Do you see a dog? Yeah, okay. I've learned I have to check these things. Well, this is the interesting thing, right? Imagine you had never seen a dog in your life. Would you recognize a dog? No, clearly not. So there's a whole epistemology here. To know what a dog is to recognize a dog. To recognize a dog is to form the right connection so that when you see this, you think dog. Knowledge, in other words, is a type of pattern recognition. To learn, to know, is to become a thing that recognizes patterns. It is to assume a set of connections in your mind so that when you look at that, a characteristic set of activations happens, and it leads you through a process of cognition. Maybe you'll say something, maybe you'll do something, maybe you'll remember something. There's a set of what I call critical literacies. Oh, that's my cat. His name is Bart. Isn't he nice? Anyhow, it's funny, right? We can find a common bond among cats, except it's not really a common bond because none of you have ever seen any of the cats that I've seen, and I have not seen any single cat that you've seen, but we can kind of communicate nonetheless. We use cats and cat pictures to talk to each other. Why does that work? Because we learn by recognizing. We learn. We see a cat, it's associated with, you know, fur and purring and niceness and happiness, except for people who hate cats, right? Because everybody's different. So there are ways underlying this, and I won't go into this in detail, but we can know about the language of recognition. The language of learning isn't the same as the language of English or the language of Armenian. The language of learning is something else. It's based in and around recognition. So that's one thing. Socially and structurally, to support this, there are new roles for government, and I'm not going to linger on these too much because none of you are in government, I don't think. Maybe you are, in which case I'm at risk of being deported. I'm just kidding. Supporting communication and educational infrastructure, open educational resources, free learning and management of assessment. The digital infrastructure is really important. You probably know this. People who funded rooms like this know this. Having that backbone of information is important. It's like you need electricity in a society, you need plumbing, water in a society, you need information in a society. If you want a learning society, you need a learning infrastructure. It's as important as water, as important as electricity. Not as important as food, you really need food. That means things like local access. One of the great things about Yerevan is all the cafes have Wi-Fi. That is so cool. You guys are wonderful. It is so nice walking around the city and being able to use my own phone and access the internet. It's such a huge advantage that you have. A lot of places aren't like that. It also means a legal framework supporting open access to the internet. It means policies on digital rights. You need to have laws that both respect the right of creators, but also because you need to be able to share and communicate in order to learn, you have to have laws and policies that respect the right of reuse. We call that, fair, I'm missing the word. In Canada, it's fair dealing. I think it's fair use in the United States. You also need a legal framework of net neutrality and similar regulations so that the internet, the pipe for the infrastructure, becomes something that is owned by and used by everybody. There's a debate taking place in my country right now and in the United States about whether providers of internet access can charge corporations and broadcasters and publishers for privileged access to the network, which would mean that we become, instead of content creators, we become simply consumers of content. And so if you're looking at internet legislation in this country, you need to watch for regulations concerning net neutrality. People always say, well, there isn't enough money for all of this internet backbone. My response is, governments always find money for the things they really value. It seems to be true here that there's no shortage of money for roads in the city anyways. Outside the city, less so. In my country, there's always money for roads. There's never money for buses, which is an odd sort of thing. A government that really values knowledge, learning, and communication will find the resources for it at the expense of other things. Sustaining infrastructure, what I mean by this is, first of all, support for existing programs that actually help in the creation and sharing of learning resources. So a really good example, I'm on a different slide in my head. Okay. What I mean by that, sorry, I was on a different slide. I was going to give you a really good example, but it's on the next slide. So what I mean by that is the promotion of policies and regulations that support and encourage the creation of resources by people in the community. I'll just move to the next slide because I can't get it over my head. Support for open educational resources. On the one hand, we have resources that are traditionally developed by a government. For example, data, policy statements, all of that. These should be made available as resources that can be used by people for learning for free. As well, for public policy, there should be, first of all, mandates for government-funded resources to be made available to the people of the country because they paid for them, and as well, support for basic literacies and community empowerment. In other words, giving people the capacity to create resources for themselves. And I don't necessarily mean a big, beautiful computer lab like this, although this is a big, beautiful computer lab. You know, even things like there was a thing called the One Laptop Per Child initiative. Now, there were lots of weaknesses in that initiative, but one of the things that they tried to do was to put small, cheap computers into the hands of children. That's really important. Putting these resources, putting the capacity to create into the hands of people teaches them at a very young age that they're not simply consumers of knowledge, they're creators of knowledge, and that's what builds that community. Sustaining open educational resources, sustaining, and let me be clear about this. When I say open educational resource, I don't just mean a piece of content that I give you and that you study. An open educational resource is content, but it's content like the MacGuffin. We use these resources like we use cat photos. We share them with each other. We use them as a language of communication rather than as stuff we have to memorize. We need to be feeding our society with these. It's like providing a vocabulary for people. So there needs to be support for community-based open educational resource processes, mechanisms and means by which people who already have knowledge can create resources that allow them to share that knowledge with other people in the community. That picture of coffee that I showed on the first slide, there's a way of making that coffee. I'm sure there is. I don't know how it's made. I assume you just put coffee and water in, but whatever. There should be a way for a person who's an expert in making that coffee to share that knowledge with the community, not just here, but around the world. Software and service support. These are important initiatives. Somebody said to me that the people here built their own learning environment. That sort of initiative is a good initiative. In Canada, we have a thing called the Public Knowledge Project. And what they do is they make something called open journal systems. It's a way for any person to create their own academic journal. You use this software, you can create your own journal. Hundreds of journals have done this. Support for that sort of effort is a valuable initiative and should be supported by government. As well, around the world, there are examples of government networks that support learning and learning technologies. Britain especially has JISC, Joint Information Services Committee, and CETUS, which I can't remember what it stands for, but they do educational technology. There's the Common Services, e-framework in Australia. There was something called the Education Network Australia, or EDNA. These national bodies that support learning resources and learning technology are an important part of the infrastructure. And then sustaining the regulations and the framework that promote not just free content, not just open content, but free content. This includes advocacy for open source software, which is why it's good that you brought Richard Stallman here a few years ago. But it's also important to engage the community, not just in using this software, but in creating software for themselves. Software, again, learning about software isn't just about buying software, it's about making software. I'm here on this stage because I make software. And I make software because, for me, making software is a form of literacy. It's a way of saying what I want to say. It's just I say it in bits and it's instead of sentences. Finally, assessment and credentials. There's two aspects to this. The first aspect is imagining a time when we move beyond institutional credentials. It's hard to do right now because university degrees and diplomas are very important and people still need them. So I'm not saying give up on that. But we need to be looking forward to a time when each individual person has his or her own unique education and what that will look like. Because that is going to be the way we support a diverse, open, and interactive learning environment. That is how a society will be able to most increase its learning. And it's sort of ironic. One of the side effects of the greatly increased access to university degrees is that the university degree itself has become one of the greatest barriers to social mobility. You need this degree. Without this degree, people think that you're uneducated. But you're not uneducated, you just don't have this degree. And so this thing that everybody's supposed to have becomes this really huge barrier to those who are poor or those who, for one reason or another, cannot obtain a university degree. So we need to be thinking about and looking at ways of approaching education beyond the degree to remove that aspect of the degree which has become a barrier. The first part of this is personal learning. The first part of this is allowing people to create their own learning environment, their own body of resources, their own personal knowledge that they've grown and they've developed over the years. The second part of this is imagining a system of assessment of learning which is not based on traditional institutional assessments. And here is where I disagree with OER University. Here is where the real change is going to happen in learning. Once we have a sufficiently interactive social network, we will be able to use that network to evaluate and assess people directly rather than use a proxy or intermediary like a university. Think about me. Think about why I'm here. Am I here because I have degrees in education or computer science? Well, no. My education's in philosophy. I'm completely unqualified. But except, you know, I'm not, right? Or some of you assume I'm not and just hoping and going along for the ride. You know about me because of my social presence. You know about me because of the work that I've done and shared online on the internet with my community. Not as someone who's world famous, but someone who has a community, and then the knowledge of my work goes from person to person to person to person, and eventually it reaches somebody in Armenia who says, hey, it'd be neat to have them talk. And it's that kind of model that will characterize assessment in the future. Think about it. How do we really know somebody is qualified to be a doctor, right? Do we say they are qualified to be a doctor because they took a course and passed the test? I wouldn't trust my life with such a person. I would not trust my life with a person who became a doctor simply and only through a traditional education. I would not. And you shouldn't either. What we do, in fact, is we take the doctor, or we take an aspiring doctor, and we put that person in a hospital where they become what is called an intern. And real doctors watch this person. And they look at every aspect of what they do in the hospital. They look at their activity, in other words, in the hospital network. And through a large number of factors, which you could never actually list, the real doctor recognizes whether or not the intern is, in fact, a doctor. You know, one doctor knows that another person is a doctor by recognizing. There's a whole bunch of clues. Do they use the words the right way? When they use a scalpel, do they put the pointy end down? Stuff like that. There's a whole lot of subtle, nuanced things. It's what Thomas Kuhn said, having that background knowledge that helps you answer the questions at the end of the chapter. It's a way of thinking about the world. You can't test for it. You can't test for whether a person sees the world as a doctor, or as a philosopher, or as an educator, but you can perceive it and recognize it if you have the capacity to see that person in action. That's what the internet gives us. So, as a role of public policy, we need to be thinking about post-credential-based assessment. How are we going to use the artifacts and the activities that people undertake online in order to assess their suitability for a job or for a career? Something to think about. All right, it's been a long talk. I'm sorry. You've been so patient. Really, really, really patient. I would have left like an hour ago. This is the old model of a school. Everybody's in their classroom. That's where you learn, right? You go to a classroom, you take books, and the old model of a new school is you have all kinds of networks. So you go to this special place, and you're all connected to a computer. That's the wrong model. This is the real model of the school of the future. This is not a school. It's kind of hard to tell. It's one of my drawings, so it's not very good. But that's not a school. That's a community. There's a courthouse. There's a grocery store. There's a hairdresser. There's a computer service area. There's a gas station. People are in the community learning what they need to learn. It's learning by experience, learning by immersion. There will be a time when the bulk of our learning happens outside these educational institutions, where the bulk of our learning happens in the communities, working with people who already know, learning directly from them. That only happens, though, when we think of our learning and resource infrastructure as a network that encompasses all of society and not just the educational institutions, where it becomes a part of a person's job, not just to do their job, but to teach the next person who will be doing their job in a few years. This is what the world looks like now. You might not believe it, but this is it. This is all of human knowledge right there. You know, it's not nice, neat silos. It's not physics, mathematics, geology, geography, history. All of these different, these are all different journals in different subject areas. Music, plant biology, ecology, architecture, geography. And the lines represent citations from one journal to another journal. All of our knowledge in all of our different disciplines is connected. Look at music. Okay, it's not connected. It's music is connected to architecture and design. It's connected to religion. That's no surprise. Ecology is connected to architecture and design. Environmental science and geography to classical studies. Sports medicine to cognitive science. It's a huge network. Our whole society is learning in this way. And that's why it makes no sense to take a person and put them in a box and have them learn one dot. Makes no sense. So we need to be thinking about how we get our students out of the classroom and into the world. And that is something that we can do now that we have connectivity, interaction, communication, openness, autonomy, and diversity. Community is interactions. It's not simply spreading the word, but it's all of us together in a single conversation building knowledge not just in ourselves, but for ourselves. It's not based on one person propagating an idea. You will forget this entire talk, except maybe its length, tomorrow. It's based on the conversation. Open communities, including this one, this is Armenia. Speak many languages, live many ways, have many different values. And that's me in my cell in the monastery. thank you.